Hello, Royal Ones, and welcome back to the channel. Welcome to my home. Today, I am going to be doing something that I haven't done for a very long time. In fact, I don't even know if I have done it in the past in my near 8 years here on YouTube. So I left a comment in the community section asking people for questions, comments, topics, things they wanted to know, and then I would read them out and answer them. So here I am. I will leave another comment similar, so you can get yours in as well. So let's start off. Let's just go straight into it. We've got one from Steve Ellis 9065. Hello, Steve, who says, saw the state opening of the Danish Parliament yesterday, very different from ours. Yes, Queen Marguerite was in attendance and watching on from the balcony with the Crown Prince and Crown Princess, but it was, who I assume, the Speaker who gave the speech. Our state opening of Parliament is on the 7th of November. Yes, it is. And the first King's speech in over 70 years. Yes, it will be. It'll be the first time, obviously, since the passing of Her Late Majesty Queen Elizabeth II, that a male sovereign, reigning sovereign, will be opening Parliament here in the United Kingdom. It is a monumental change, but we'll get to that in a moment. I don't think that's just your question. With Prince William away, it will be interesting to see if any other councillors of state will join the King. Right, first of all, let's just tackle the monumental occasion that is the state opening of Parliament anyway. I always love state opening of Parliament. It always happens round about this time of the year, unless there's something weird that's happened, which means that it has to be moved. But it's always a bit like the kind of, well, it is, it's the start of kind of the parliamentary year. And it sort of, it renews that symbiotic relationship between Parliament, state, the monarchy, and of course the country and the people. It kind of reaffirms all of those bonds, all of those links, and it is full, the ceremony is packed full of symbolism. Now, for those of you wondering if anything will change, that is highly unlikely. I don't think we will see any change in the state opening of Parliament ceremony. In fact, actually, changes were made to accommodate the late Queen's declining health over the last sort of 5 years, if you like. Most notably, of course, that in her absence, it was Charles as Prince of Wales who actually kind of opened Parliament on his late mother's behalf. So I think that actually changes will be rolled back to kind of how things were sort of 5-6 years ago. For example, Her Late Majesty took the lift in more recent years. So we will have, of course, King Charles III and Queen Camilla ascending the ceremonial stairs, going to the robing room, wearing the crown, because of course in recent years the crown was carried in front of. So now King Charles III will actually be wearing the imperial state crown, not the St Edward's crown. It is expected, although not confirmed, we don't actually know if this will be the first time that Her Majesty Queen Camilla will wear the George IV state diadem, that beautiful kind of diamond diadem that Her Late Majesty wore to the state opening of Parliament and then changed out of. I'm thinking that she will. My prediction is she will, is that she will. My hope is that she will, but we don't actually know. So yeah, we'll have to wait and see, but it would be the perfect opportunity for Queen Camilla to debut that tiara on her head. Now, the question was, will any other councillors of state be there? Again, that is entirely kind of unknown. I think that William and Catherine will attend, just the same way that Charles and Diana used to attend behind Her Majesty and the Duke of Edinburgh. Then obviously it became Charles and Camilla that followed behind on numerous occasions over the past sort of 20 years. So I would expect William and Catherine to be following suit, if you like. Yeah, I definitely think so. Will anyone else be there? Who knows? I mean, I imagine we'll still have all the pomp and the circumstance and we'll have the carriage rides. I mean, like I say, it really is an important ceremony. It's one that looks like it's kind of unnecessary and not needed, but it's one that really does reaffirm those bonds. So thank you, Steve, for that question. The Slovian says, George and Louis will likely go to Eton, but where will Princess Charlotte go? Any suggestions? What did the other females do, Eugenie, Beatrice and Lady Louise? Right. When it comes to the royal men in the family, there isn't a lot of deviation. Of course, you know, Prince Charles, as Prince of Wales, famously detested Gordonstoun up in Scotland. Of course, the Duke of Edinburgh, his father, completely excelled there. And he thought that Charles would kind of toughen up and man up and really kind of enjoy the outdoor pursuits and that kind of rough and tumble lifestyle. He didn't. He absolutely hated it and had a miserable time there. In fact, he used to hop on over at the weekends to relatively close by Burke Hall, which of course is now one of his Scottish homes, including Balmoral as well. It's on the Balmoral estate. And he used to take solace with his grandmother. So I think gone are those days where royal children, male or female, are just sent away somewhere because of tradition. I think now, you know, there has to be kind of a reason and there has to be geographical locations, family life factored in. I don't think it's quite as simple as just sending them away. So the males typically go to Eton, not entirely the case, but most the kind of royals go to Eton. William and Harry went to Eton College. And it's expected that George will go there too. Hello, Rory, in the background. I'm sure we'll be seeing him a few times. So I think it's pretty much a dead cert. George was seen visiting. So I think it's a pretty dead cert that he will go there. As for the females in the family, again, there's been a lot of variation. There hasn't really been terribly... basically, all options are open. Princess Anne went to Benenden School. Now, Princess Anne famously sort of wasn't really an academic. I'm not saying that she's, you know, she hasn't got brains. Of course she's got brains. It's Princess Anne. But I don't think she enjoyed the academic life. I think when she left school, she just thought, well, hey, you know, I am a princess of the United Kingdom. My mother's the queen. What am I going to do? Well, you know, I've already got kind of the family business, a family firm to go into. So I will enter royal life. And Princess Anne has been doing her thing ever since. So she has been a hardworking royal since leaving school. So further education was not really on the cards for her. And of course, she had sporting pursuits as well to kind of keep her entertained and busy. Princess Beatrice went to Goldsmiths and Princess Eugenie went to Marlborough. Let's not forget that Princess Beatrice also has dyslexia. So she kind of found kind of academia a little bit difficult and problematic. So lots of different variations within the royal ladies in the family. So Princess Charlotte has a myriad of opportunities. Now, there is talk, rumours, that perhaps Eton could go co-educational and could start accepting females for the first time. If that is the case, then Princess Charlotte could potentially even go to Eton. We don't know, the world is changing and, you know, hey, maybe it will in time for Princess Charlotte. But I think certainly geographically, it will be in that kind of vicinity. Unless, of course, Princess Charlotte literally says, hey, Mom, Dad, see you later. I want to be off. And, you know, literally goes somewhere. So, again, good question. But the simple answer is we don't entirely know. And we are going to have to wait and see. Catherine says, as Catherine E., 2198 says, when King Charles III is no longer with us, who will support Andrew? Well, I mean, of course, we're presuming that Andrew outlives King Charles III. It is entirely possible there is an age gap, but as we know with life, nothing is a dead cert. So the simple answer is we don't actually know the full extent, as I've said in a previous video, we don't know the full extent of Prince Andrew's finances. We don't know how much he was left in the Queen Mother's legacy. We don't know how much he was left in the Duke of Edinburgh's legacy. We don't know how much he was left in Her Late Majesty's legacy, although we do anticipate that the majority, the bulk of it, went monarch to monarch transfer. So the simple answer is we don't know how much he's got, and we don't know how much he received from Her Late Majesty before her passing with regards to supporting any payments that he had to make in recent years. So, and also he's kind of, you know, Sarah Ferguson, Sarah Duchess of York, has come out and said that she's kind of found it, you know, that now it's her time to support the York family. So he does have support outside of King Charles III, even if his budget has kind of been slashed in half. So the simple answer is, I don't think anybody will support him from the royal side once, for example, William becomes king and ascends the throne. I don't think William will be supporting his uncle. That is, of course, if his uncle is still with us at that time. So I think, again, like with most royal watching, it's a case of we have to kind of wait and see what happens. LHodge8672 says, will King Charles keep the late Queen's racing stable? Yes, he has. There has been no stripping of the royal stable. And of course, Camilla, Queen Camilla, loves horses as much as Her Late Majesty. It is a passion that both of them shared and both of them bonded over. The Queen, so basically, the King owns the stables. They are his royal stud. And there are stud farms at Sandringham and Windsor. So there are horses everywhere. But it is a proper working stud farm, which means that you breed horses, the horses have foals, you raise them up, and some of them you sort of intend, once they've been trained or whatever, to sell on. So people have got a little bit confused. Shortly after the late Queen's passing, there was talk that King Charles was, like, you know, selling off 15 horses. Basically, that is typical anyway. Normally, the Her Late Majesty would sell some horses. I think there was like maybe 5 or 6 more sold that particular year. But it just kind of goes to show that they'd obviously reared that amount of horses, which needed, you kind of have to have that ebb and flow when it comes to a stud. You know, it's a working stud. It is run as a business to kind of make money to keep it going, blah blah blah. So yes, it's still there in its entirety, and we believe that Queen Camilla is taking a very keen interest and kind of overseeing that operation. Will it ever be, you know, as big or as large as under Her Late Majesty? Again, that remains to be seen, but it certainly hasn't gone, and it has been retained. Mary McMillan 348 says, yes, the Queen and King are going to Kenya. Great news. Yes, and there was another comment. Betty Mark mentions Kenya. We'll get to Kenya at the end because I've got something interesting to read all about that. And of course, the importance of that visit, because it is a very important visit. So I'll tackle that at the end. MGPM17 says, has any rarely seen jewellery been seen on the royals lately? No, as far as I'm concerned, I haven't seen any sort of, you know, pieces that we haven't seen for decades and decades and decades. I think Queen Camilla wore a brooch recently that the Queen, Her Late Majesty, only wore a few times since inheriting off her mother, the late Queen Mother. But other than that, we haven't really seen anything kind of dragged out of the vaults that we don't really know about. And of course, we're still waiting for the royal family order, which I'm hoping will be revealed at the next state banquet. And, you know, they've had enough time to make it and create it, and it would be the perfect time to debut it. Also, I'm waiting to see the debut of lots of her late Majesty's tiaras. We've seen Queen Camilla, you know, wearing some of the more larger pieces, but she's kind of kept her selection very limited. We have seen her, of course, in the Shand tiara, which is her sort of family tiara, that she doesn't own, I don't think, but she sort of uses from time to time. We've seen her, of course, in the Greville honeycomb tiara. We've seen her in a kind of blue sapphire tiara. I'd love to see her in debuting some more pieces, and I'd love to see her kind of delving into her late Majesty's brooch collection. Can you imagine being able to go into that jewellery vault? I don't even know what the jewellery vault looks like. I'd love to talk to Angela Kelly, the late Queen's former dresser, because she was also kind of curator of the personal jewellery collection. I would love to know how they're stored. Are they in just one vault, or is it lots of vaults? I'd love to know all about the jewellery. So, for example, you know, will we see her in a Coco Chanel tiara or a Russian fringe? Maybe she'll stay away from the Russian stuff. but no, I mean, there are lots of tiaras and brooches and necklaces and all kinds of things. So I want to see them, and I know you guys do as well. Kathy Springberg 4383. There's lots of numbers with people's names. Has there been any hints in the British media about whether Beatrice and Eugenie would accept an offer from King Charles to become working royals? No. It's always been spoken about. I mean, ever since when I started back in 2015, I was talking about Beatrice and Eugenie becoming working royals even back then, and that's always been my sincere hope. And for those of you that have been watching me that long, I've always predicted that there would be a need for Beatrice and Eugenie to be utilised. They are, of course, blood princesses of the United Kingdom. And they've always found themselves in a bit of a precarious, between a rock and a hard place type situation. Sort of damned if they do, damned if they don't. Basically, they've navigated a really tough position to be in. They are titled royals. They are relatively high up in the line of succession, although, you know, very unlikely to ever become sovereigns themselves. So whenever they sort of do something or step out, it sort of draws criticism because of their titles. But I think they haven't really misstepped, apart from maybe going on a few holidays and being called out for having lots of holidays. They've always worked, you know, they've always had their own independent jobs. They've married well, both girls. Of course, a little help and support from mommy and daddy along the way. And of course, grandma, I'm sure, hasn't gone amiss. But they've worked hard. Andrew and say what you like about Andrew and Sarah. The one thing they've done well is raise two really well-adjusted, grounded girls. You don't see them showing off. You don't see them being pretentious. They have their charitable causes, which they support privately. Whenever they have been called upon to, you know, attend Her Late Majesty, they've done so with grace and elegance and not really made a fuss or not tried to overshadow. They've been really dutiful and loyal, and I think they would make, for those reasons, I think they would make excellent working royals, and I've always said so. And I've always felt a bit of criticism towards King Charles's Prince of Wales, as he was then, his kind of notion of this slimmed-down monarchy, because slim it down too much, and you reduce the capacity for that reach of the royal family. You just reduce it. And I think at the moment we are in a dangerous, precarious situation. And now we are getting not just me talking about Beatrice and Eugenie coming in, but we're also getting viewers as well. I think there is a public appetite for it. And I think if it happened, I don't think many people would bat an eyelid, to be quite honest. Fuzzy Puppet says, I saw someone on X, formerly Twitter. I still can't get used to that. I don't like the whole X thing. the app, it looks like adult content on the app, and I don't like it. Anyway, claiming that as long as King Charles includes Harry and Meghan in the royal family website, he's condoning their behaviour. Can you speak to that? Well, yes, I can. So the royal family website is a big, clonking website. You know, the royal family has had a website for a long, 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 long time, and there is so much information of engagements, and there's so much on it. And it was announced at the passing of Her Late Majesty that it would be updated, but it would take time. And that is kind of what we have seen. Slowly, things are being changed. People's titles are being updated within previously existing pieces that have been written and published. So it's going to take a long time. What I think they should have done is prioritised what needs updating first. So for example, we had issues regarding the line of succession not being updated quick enough, or rather it was updated quick for some and then it wasn't updated quick for others, and it wasn't even updated correctly for others. I mean, I made lots of videos on that. So there was a lot of kind of, it's not been updated in the best kind of way. It hasn't been prioritised. And one of the things that I think kind of caused ripples when it really shouldn't was, of course, when it was updated that Harry and Meg, well, Prince Harry, sort of lost the HRH, which, of course, he hasn't lost it. He still has the HRH, but they removed it from the website, which then made people think, well, has King Charles removed the HRH? No, he hasn't. He's just stopped using it on the website. That's all that meant. And because that wasn't done in a timely manner, people thought that something had changed now, when it hasn't. It's just a case of they've been very painfully slow to get things changed and amended, and it's still going on now. They should have prioritised what needed doing first, what people really sort of look at first. Like, for example, the line of succession, the individual royals' profiles, and all of these are being updated, but they haven't all been updated at the same time. I do think, with regards to what Harry and Meghan are doing now, and of course their relationship with the royal family, I think the current sort of bio of Prince Harry and Meghan, the Duke and Duchess of Sussex, reads sort of quite favourably. But I don't necessarily think that it is up to date. It still talks about sort of splitting their time between North America and the UK, which of course now we know they don't have a home here. So it desperately needs updating. And I think it should just be very factual and very simple. So for example, it could read something like the Duke of Sussex, Prince Harry, youngest son of King Charles III, currently fifth in line to the throne, married to the Duchess of Sussex, Meghan, and they reside in North America with their two children, King Charles III's grandchildren, Prince Archie and Princess Lilibet of Sussex. End of. I don't think they need any more than that. Everything that I've just said now is factual, it's correct, and it is current. So I just think it needs updating, basically. Okay, now we can get to Kenya. Well, I can't actually physically take you to Kenya, but we can talk about it. So this article was, it's from the BBC News. So, you know, it should be factual and correct as much as can be. It was published on the 11th of October, 2023. And it tells us all we need to know so far about the royal visit Kenya. So, it is said that the King will acknowledge painful aspects of the UK's relationship with Kenya during a state visit later this month. Queen Camilla will join him on the four-day trip to Kenya, his first to a Commonwealth nation as monarch. So this is a very poignant visit. It coincides with the country celebrating the 60th anniversary of its independence from Britain. So a very monumental occasion to go. That followed a violent uprising in which thousands of people were killed. Kenyans consider the Mau Mau Rebellion to be one of the most significant steps towards the end of British rule in the country. The uprising began in the early 1950s as the country's major ethnic grouping grew increasingly resentful of their British rulers over white settler expansion and lack of political representation. So it is, there's a lot of history to acknowledge when it comes to that occasion. And King Charles has made no secret of the fact that he wants to tackle these issues or face them head on. He's already opened up the archives, or he's given permission for scholars to go in and have access to documents and to kind of look at Britain, the royal family's role in these kinds of issues. A Foreign Office spokesperson said the trip will celebrate and drive forward the UK's partnership with Kenya. They added that the government is committed to ensuring Kenya sees the UK as a partner of choice. And I think that is very important. And we spoke in, I think it was the last video I made, about the Commonwealth, or one of the videos I made, about the Commonwealth and how I thought that when it comes to changes, that a lot of change would come from the Commonwealth, from Britain's relationship to the rest of the Commonwealth. Of course, all members of the Commonwealth are regarded as equal partners. And I think that one of the things that is really going to change is that relationship of choice. It has to be one that the member states want to actively be part of, rather than perhaps feeling obliged because of previous colonial ties. And I think that is a notion that King Charles will want to encourage and sort of foster, that it's one of choice, that there are lots of common ground, that there are lots of aspects of life that we can come together on and work mutually, so that there are mutual benefits for the United Kingdom and the Commonwealth countries of working and collaborating together. So good question, and I'm really excited to see that visit. Okay, that's the end of all the questions. I will be posting another comment asking for more questions in due course, so look out for that, and of course get your questions in. Thank you for watching this video. If you have enjoyed it, please give it a big old thumbs up. Don't forget to share on social media, and of course, do hit the bell so that you know whenever I upload a new video. From me, mwah to you all, and goodbye.